Hello, I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE, here at our NYSE CUBE studios, the NYSE and theCUBE, partnering with NYSE Wired program, building out a new community of trusted leaders, part of our physics and physical AI series. Physics is the big buzzword. It deals with robotics, AI technology. Rajat Bhageria is here, founder and CEO of Chef Robotics. Back on theCUBE, recently was part of our AI infrastructure robotics leaders series in June. Rajat, great to see you again. Thanks for coming to our New York studio,
yes.
NYSE Wired CUBE here. Thanks for being part of the team.
Thanks for having me.
Talk about, real set the table, Chef Robotics, what you guys do. Brian Bauman had a nice demo at your facility a couple months ago, and the momentum you have.
Yeah, so what we do is basically make AI-enabled robots for the food industry. The big pain point in the food industry, as with many industries, is there's a big labor shortage. 1.1 million people that these companies are looking to hire only expect to get worse. And so basically what happens is that traditional automation, which is kind of dispensers, depositors, doesn't work. So they end up having to rely on people to do this redundant work. We built robots that can help automate the assembly part of that, which is actually 60 to 70% of labor. So in terms of momentum, we've now made, I think, 73 million servings, which is awesome. That's more than essentially all the other kind of food robotics companies essentially combined, which is really cool. And one thing that's interesting about Chef is that we're starting not in restaurants, but rather in manufacturing. So today, like if you go to Trader Joe's or Whole Foods or Costco or what have you, and you get a frozen prepared meal or a fresh prepared meal, odds are that's actually made by Chef, which is pretty cool. The vision of the company is that if we can actually use this training data about how do you manipulate like rice and not clump up, how do you manipulate like a grape and not crush it, how do you manipulate like sauce so you spread it over a tray, like if you can learn how to manipulate food in a factory, then the training data is training data that you can kind of apply all over the place.
So grab and goes, we have been there.
Yes.
Whole Foods, that's my lunch, little sushi here, salads.
Correct.
And then also it's large volume coming in. So is there a certain kind of food that's use cases out of the gate that are more aligned with what you guys are doing?
I think, you know, one thing that we realize is like most food, if you think about it, is like we call scoopable, which is to say like you scoop it with an ice cream scoop with your hands. Yeah. So like even a yogurt parfait or a burrito, like yes, you have to fold the burrito, but inside it's all scoopable stuff. Most stuff on a sandwich is scoopable. Right, so that's where we started. So we've done like 2,000 plus ingredients. Most of it is in a tray, but now we've kind of more recently done like wraps, burritos, sandwiches, things like this, like an egg sandwich type of thing. The next kind of thing we're kind of expanding into is more like what's called piece-picked food, which is like I want one chicken breast, I want one salmon fillet, I want to make one burger patty, things like this. And that kind of is the universe of food, basically. It's, food is either scooped or piece-picked.
So what is the state of the art of robotics today, for at least in your sort of use cases, because are you building learning systems as opposed to the sort of standard see, think, and act, you know, rules-based system? Can you explain like where we are today?
Yeah, it's a great question. So maybe I even take it even before like all the AI stuff. Like the robotics as of old has been around for 40, 50 years, right? I mean, if you go to a Ford factory, you see lots of robots. You know, these robots are essentially hard-coded though, right? They do this motion all day long and they're very good at it. But they have very few sensors, they have very little software. And so those kind of pieces of equipment work very well for what's called in manufacturing low mix manufacturing. What low mix essentially entails is like, there's one line, and line one is gonna do this product all day long. So there's the Ford F-150 line, it's gonna do Ford F-150s all day long. Or there's the AirPods Pro line, that's just gonna do AirPods Pro all day long. It's not gonna make an iPhone. That's kind of a solved problem. Now, that's still not easy, by the way. There's a lot of work that goes into that, but it's essentially like there's systems integrators who are very good at doing this. What's changing in the world, of course, is that manufacturers and people, consumers want choice. In the food world, you don't want the same Stouffer's dinner every single night, right? You want choice. So what's happening is there's this explosion in SKUs, products. So in the food industry, instead of having five products like Coca-Cola does, you might have 500 products. You have you know vegan meals and meat lovers meals and gluten-free meals, and each of those sectors has its own 50 SKUs.
Yeah.
So if you have 300 different SKUs, you're not going to have 300 custom dedicated lines you're going to pay $500,000 for. That's not a good economic idea. Instead, what you do is you get flexible lines. These lines kind of go from doing one meal to the other meal to the other meal all day long. So I think that's really where we're seeing, okay, well, we can actually leverage more AI and machine learning to take essentially all the existing hardware. Like, let's not try to reinvent the hardware stack. Let's take collaborative robots, let's take RGBD cameras, let's take NVIDIA GPUs, Intel CPUs, et cetera, and let's add AI and ML to make these robots flexible enough to go from doing diced onions to peas to mashed potatoes to whatever throughout the day.
But they set up the runs though, right? It's not like it's intermixed.
They set up the runs.
And so that's where the simulation comes in. That's where kind of that we're seeing the digital twins and the software side of it. So you're multi-purpose on the robotics.
Yes.
Dave, I always say this on the Cube Pod. It's like the Matrix, you know, upload how to fly a helicopter. In a way, the robots are programmable.
Yes.
And then the lines go. You service the order.
Yes.
They wait.
Yes.
New update comes in. So it's pluggable.
Correct.
Programming.
Correct. Yeah, and exactly. So like our customers can basically, our customers are getting new customers. Their customers are changing what meals they want every single week, month, honestly. So they're constantly saying, okay, instead of this meal, I want to do this meal. And so they can very quickly kind of onboard new ingredients and new meals. And we have this really nice like VLM-based system where they can actually say, okay, well, I want to do this new ingredient, upload a photo, and basically we'll predict the robot motion that the system should take with that new ingredient.
And by choice of the name you chose, suggests you're going to be in this industry for a while.
Yes.
I wonder if you could explain that, the market dynamic, because you're not trying to build general purpose consumer robots that fold my laundry.
Yes.
You're really focused on this industry.
Yes.
What's the thinking there?
No, it's a really good question. I think robotics is really hot right now, but when we started in 2019, it was a bit of a winter. Mm-hmm. And there was a slew of dead robotics companies. You probably know many of them.
We've seen them all,
A
lot of dead bodies.
A lot of dead bodies. And so my thinking was, okay, look, if I'm going to do, I think everyone agrees on the vision of robots. Like, we all agree with that. But the reality at the time, at least in 2019, was stark. So I was okay, if I'm going to do something, I need to be very practical. And so trying to build a general purpose system was technically not really tenable, frankly. And I would even argue today, this idea of a general purpose system is probably... I mean,
they're out there.
They're out there.
The Matrix will come soon where you have more agility in the robotics.
Yes.
But you guys already have fine tuning or you have a robotics that could pick a grape.
Yes, yes.
So you got the advancements in the hardware software.
Yes, yes.
But you said you were going to dominate a niche, and this is a big niche.
Exactly. So we start, the thinking of the chef is start in food manufacturing. That's an industry that's a giant industry all over the planet. Everyone in the world has prepared meals. Okay, start there. What happens there? A few things happen. The most important thing is we learn how to manipulate food. Training data is training data, right? If I can, like you said, pick up a grape, I can do that in Sweetgreen. I can do that in Travis Kalanick's Cloud Kitchens, right? So we start there. We can actually get revenue. We get operational backbone about how do you manufacture robots. We get operational backbone on how do you service robots. We reduce our bill of materials by getting volume with our suppliers. We get case studies about in the food industry. And the most important thing is this training data. And then over time, we go from high volume kitchens to lower and lower volume kitchens. So the next kind of step for us is commissaries, kind of central production kitchens, but they're not factories. So imagine airline caterings, central commissaries, imagine cloud kitchens. That's kind of step two.
Yeah.
Step three is kind of the day-to-day kitchen, right? Mm-hmm. Fast casuals, prisons, hotels, stadiums, event venues.
Talk about the business model, and Dave and I were talking before we even started doing interviews today about Michael Dell and his innovation around supply chain. He would put the suppliers near his factory so they'd be close. Obviously, food is perishable.
Yes.
You're in San Francisco. Distribution of the food is important. What's your plans on that? And two, you mentioned cloud kitchens. Yes. Are they a customer?
Yes.
Or a distributor? Or take us through the market selection of one, you're thinking around the distribution, orders, servicing them, and then partners.
Yeah, so it's actually interesting, even from our customer's perspective, by the way, this is not exactly what you're asking, but it's an interesting kind of point to make, and I'll answer your question. A lot of our customers are actually thinking of offshoring parts of their supply chain because they can't have enough labor. And obviously the current administration policy is not helping this.
Right.
So, that's also kind of a strong why now, why robots need to exist. We can't outsource food. That's not good for the US, by any stretch of the imagination, right? But to answer your question, honestly, most of our customers are not in San Francisco or something, right? We're there because of talent. There's the best AI engineers, ML engineers, robotics engineers, that's why we are there. But our suppliers are all over the country and the world. We get our robots from Denmark, we get a lot of parts from Germany, we get some parts from China, kind of globalized supply chain. And then our customers are also all over the US and Canada, usually outside of major cities. We have some customers in New Jersey, we have some customers in upstate New York, Idaho, Oregon. It's kind of where you'd expect kind of factories.
And you're shipping the food from San Francisco? Or
No. We ship the robots.
Oh, you ship the robot. Okay, so that's what I'm saying.
Exactly. So we build these robot modules, and these robot modules are the same kind of footprint as a person.
Yeah.
We put them in crates, ship them out to our customers.
Cloud Kitchen deals with the food, right?
So they buy your robots, or at least whatever you mentioned, you do it.
So today we're actually not doing cloud kitchens. Today we're doing factories. today we'd be going to like the guys.
Right, that's what's the next step.
That's the next step. Yeah, Cloud Kitchen is the next step. Yeah. But yes.
But your customers are dealing with the food.
Yes, yes,
you're
exactly.
Providing the infrastructure.
And by the way, I think that's an interesting point. Like, you know, there's been a few different robotics companies that have tried to vertically integrate, which is to say they try to do the robots, they try to have the brand, they try to have the food. What we have found is that doing all three is quite hard. And my thinking is, look, Chipotle or Starbucks or what have you, or Whole Foods, they're very good at food. They've been doing it for decades, they're very good at it, and they're very good at brand. We're good at robots.
and by the way, what you know.
Exactly, and by the way, the probability of robotics company succeeding is still very hard. It's a technically extremely intense company. The probability of restaurants succeeding, I would argue, is even smaller. Now you're stacking those probabilities on top of each other, which is why a lot of these companies that have kind of vertically integrated have perished. So my thinking has always been, look, like robotics is very much a B2B thing, in my opinion. Yeah. I think like, you know, you sell to people who are very good at that end thing, and then you're very good at the AI, robotics, hardware, manufacturing, things like this.
Yeah, and they get benefits because they see cost reductions, top line growth, better product.
Yes.
I mean, it's just a win. All right, what's the hardest technical thing that you guys are working on now? Because obviously it's very fast paced.
Yes.
Physical AI is the hottest thing, and they changed our name of the series to AI robotics leaders to physical AI, because what we're talking about here is physical AI, digital and physical coming together, which is the first party relationship between software and data.
Yes.
But robotics is cool. I like
robotics. Is cool.
And we have robotics in the name. Physical AI and robotics.
Yes.
Because, you know, robotics arc is here. I mean, it's finally here.
It's
not winter.
Production. It's real. It's real.
Yeah.
Right? I think, like, it's actually a lot harder than you might imagine. So there's this law in robotics called Maravich's law. And Maravich's law basically says that the things that are very easy for humans, like picking up this cup, are exorbitantly hard for robots. And the things that are really hard for humans, like linear algebra, are really trivial for machines and robots. So I think, like, just to kind of put like a very precise example, you know, doing something as simple as like, how do you pick up rice, which is a very simple ingredient, cooked rice, jasmine rice, and how do you get 45 grams or whatever grammage the customer wants 10 million times consistently every single time is actually really hard. Because every single time, the topology of the pan of rice is changing. And by the way, humans are cooking the rice. So every single day, it's a little bit more wet or less dense or what have you. So we need a lot of sensors to say, okay, dynamically, here's how you pick from every single time to manipulate it. That gets harder, by the way, with meats. So like, imagine like a tub of like shredded chicken. Well, by the way, if you go through 10 million servings, that's a lot of different birds you're going through, which means every one of them is different. There's different densities. So basically, like dealing with like organic stuff is actually really hard.
And you're saying, because like your example of a grape before, without squashing that grape, because the human, it's very easy.
It's very trivial.
Not squash the grape.
Yes.
Because you have that tactile feel.
Tactile.
So
Yes.
So, okay. So how do you solve that problem? Is that software, hardware, integration?
It's a little bit of all of it. So I think that's like one of the key kind of insights with Chef. Like one thing that we really rely on is this idea of a utensil. It sounds like a very simple idea, but like what the humanoid companies are trying to do is build a general purpose hand.
Yeah.
But if you look in like kitchens, it's basically all utensils. Right, you have scoops, you have spoons, you have tongs, you have lots of different utensils. That makes the problem a lot more tenable for us. So, and that's not trivial, right? You have to design the right utensil, and then on top of that, you still have to figure out what pose, basically, where in the pan of food do you enter from. Then we have a pneumatic system to figure out like the pressure and the flow for the pneumatics that you pick from. So anyways, there's a bunch of different things that you have to kind of get right. Mm-hmm. And then it's like you try a bunch of stuff, right? That's where the learning comes in. You try and see what happens, and you try more. You're kind of playing with the food until you kind of converge on a policy that allows you to kind of like get all the different aspects you need right. So it's not just like picking food or not. It's like, okay, first of all, can you pick? Then it's like, can you get the right portion size? I want 80 grams. Okay, great. Then can you be consistent around the 80 grams? Then do you spill the food? Then do you crush the food? Then can you do this fast because customers want speed? Then can you do this reliably? Then can you do this not just for that particular ingredient, but the billions of other ingredients. That's what's hard.
So can you take us through, so today is the volume business. Can you take us through the business case for each of these sort of targets?
Yes.
What does it look like?
It's a great question. So, our customers really usually approach us because they can't hire the people. So the way they're thinking about this is, okay, line five over there, I can't run line five. Because line five requires 20 people, I don't have the 20 people.
Okay, so it's not a cost replacement, it's a revenue example.
Increase. Yeah, okay. So the number one thing is revenue increases. Now, to be clear, there's some factories where labor is not an issue. There's some part of the country where labor is not an issue.
So are you a fit there?
So, no, well, then there's different ROI. So in those cases, we can usually actually help them increase throughput.
Okay.
So
it's still a revenue.
It's still a revenue. So, and I think, by the way, the best businesses, in my opinion, are the ones that help other people make more money. Mm. It's not about saving costs. It's about making money. Mm. Right? So number two is throughput. Number three is we can usually help them with yield, which is to say food giveaway. The idea there is a simple one, which is people on average tend to give away or put too much food into the tray. Right? And that is a really meaningful amount of money for these food companies because 50% of revenue goes to raw materials. So if I can help them decrease the amount of giveaway by 2%, that is a huge amount of money for them. So that's three. And the fourth thing is labor. Labor is number four, though. So, you know, it's interesting because, like, you know, a lot of people have this perception of, like, oh, robots are taking jobs. Like, no, like, there's not enough jobs. Not enough people want to do work in a 34-degree room.
No, we need robots.
We need robots.
Because right, we don't have enough people.
There's not enough people.
And then those economics flow through to the other two sort of domains that you're targeting?
Yes, I believe so. I think like labor shortage is going to be generally something that persists across even like Sweetgreen, right? Why is that? Because frankly, there's much better jobs out there now, right? Like I'd rather do DoorDash or Uber or whatever else. I get to work on my own hours. I probably make more money than being in a very hot or very cold kitchen.
Yeah.
I was listening to a pitch yesterday from the VC event I was at, and the firm, their whole value proposition was basically providing staff for restaurants. And I'm like, I don't like that business. That's going to go. First of all, you're going to have a hard time finding people.
Yes.
And it's okay. So you got a limited supply of people.
Yes.
Uber drivers, that's not a problem. But,
you know,
autonomous vehicles are coming.
People, that too. People that work in, you know, for the period of time, plenty of people wanted to drive Ubers, but you can't find people
for
the restaurants. That's their biggest problem. So
that's
robots are such an obvious solution. I didn't like that pitch.
Yeah.
Talk about to close out the segment. We should have more time, but I definitely will love to see a tour.
Yeah, of course.
When I'm in San Francisco, what you're working on now? Put a plug in for the company. Share some stats.
Yep.
What are you guys looking to do? Obviously, hiring is key.
Yeah.
You're working with the GPUs. There's some tech involved.
Yes.
Share some stats, momentum. What are you looking to do? What are you optimizing for?
Yeah. So I think like in terms of like what we're working on, I think there's a few different things. Like one is like usually our customers are pretty big customers, like enterprise, like Amy's Kitchen, for example. They started with a couple of robots, now they're 20 robots. So really investing in success and making those customers successful so they buy more robots. That's like a big focus of ours. The second thing is we are expanding obviously within continental America and UK. So like kind of go to market is a big focus of mine. The third big thing that we're really focused on is saying, okay, well, look, at this point, we've made 73 million meals in production. I mean, we have a ton of training data. So how do we leverage a lot of these modern techniques like imitation learning and learning from demonstration combined with the developments with transformers and say, okay, let's leverage human demonstrations for novel ingredients plus the 73 million demonstrations from production data to make a really great kind of more generalized foundation model for food.
I like that. I like the training data because, you know, in this evolution, rapid accelerated evolution, synthetic data has been talked about because there's a lack of real-time data.
Yes.
You're getting real data.
Yes.
Computer vision, sensor data, mechanical data.
And I think, by the way, that's a really key point because like even if you look at like Waymo and Cruise, like Waymo's, I think, like anytime I see Waymo, it's like such an incredible experience. Mm. It's like magic. But if you look at Waymo, of course they do a lot of sim, but they have had kind of cars in the roads of San Francisco for like years now, 3-4 years. I mean, even deep into COVID. So they have tens of millions of miles of in-production kind of training data. So I think, like, I think honestly, part of the industry is, like, overhyping sim. I think the reality with robots is, like, there's so many edge cases. Edge cases that you can't even imagine.
Yeah.
Right? It's just, like, the unknown unknowns. And you're not going to know that unless you, like, try stuff. Like, I'll give you an example. Like, in our industry, like, we've had cases where, like, we're like, okay, we're placing onto a conveyor, relatively constrained environment. But there's humans around us. So like we see cases where like the human bumps into the conveyor. Now the conveyor is skewed. And so now the robot's like, oh, I didn't know about that. So now we have to build software that like autonomously detects that. So there's, and that's just one example. There's thousands of these examples, even in our case, which is honestly relatively constrained, which is why we started in the first place.
Yeah. That's why I love the three scaling laws that Jensen talked about last week. There's, you know, training, reinforced learning, inference, and then deep thinking.
Yeah.
Because now you have the data coming in.
Yes.
The data mode is phenomenal. So congratulations.
It's the biggest moat. I think it's like, and I think with any robotics company, that is the moat.
Rajat, thanks for coming back on. Again, we'll see you soon. You're in the fold. Thanks for being part of our community.
Yes, thank you.
At theCUBE and NYC Wired.
Great to have you.
Thanks for having me.
And congratulations on your success. Robots are cool. AI is cool. We're doing our best to be cool and bring you all the data here with theCUBE. I'm Gianfranco Dei Vellante. Thanks for watching.